inspiring Body of Christ Church is an anointed ministry where we use the Word of God to win souls for the kingdom of God. We are fishers of men, and our church is uniquely equipped with the largest privately owned aquarium in the world. All of the marine life that you see in our tanks have to go through a time of quarantine. So here is a recap of our previous episode of Quarantine with Pastor Ricky Rush.
Visitors that you could bring to church, they may find it hard to sit still during an anointed service when the music is playing, people are clapping their hands. Sometimes a visitor, a person that doesn't know the Lord, gets a little antsy and can't sit around and maybe get a little nervous. There's too much going on in church and I'm not really used to people being distracted. You know, unlike a concert when music starts and everybody's all over the place, but at church when people start honoring God, sometimes people get a little antsy, and anointed music will stir up demons and it'll set captives free. If you will just give God a shout out, if you will just give God a shout out, enemies back off, demons will back down. Sometimes your music drives other people away. God's music will drive demons away. And so David will play the harp and demons will start to leave King Saul. Why? Because David was enthused about playing. God inspired him, and he would play music that would calm the enemy down. How could David defeat this giant that he fought with just a slingshot? It wasn't much. The power of praise helped David. The power of praise will help you.
Thank you, Father.
And now, another episode of Quarantine with Pastor Ricky Rush.
For revealing your word to me today.
Welcome to church. Tell somebody, I love my church. Now, don't lie. Seriously, if you love your church, give them a high five and say, I love my church.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, this morning we thank you because now we get a chance to hear from you. Father, in the name of Jesus, someone right now, along with me, is so grateful for this opportunity to hear a word, to be alive. In the midst of everything going on, God, we know you are so good. And you, God, you're what's going on. Thank you today for the soul that's going to be blessed by this word. I pray that you would use it for clarity, make it simple. And Lord, I just want you to use every bit of me that you can to simplify this word. Thank you for that person who is, wherever they are listening, that they could continue to stay focused on the word and not blame the church and not blame you, Jesus, for us not being able to be in this building. You mean more to us than for us to act selfish because you set us aside for the safety of all of us. In the name of Jesus, simplify your word. Amen. Well, here we are, episode 122 of Quarantined. That means that for 122 episodes or more, because there were some that we didn't put on the screen, or more, we have been set aside. We've been set by ourselves. We've been in a part where we've had to learn to hear from God, speak to God, pray and praise God, be a part of fellowship, and not have any people around us. You know, the quarantine is really important in this ministry because God has blessed us with an aquatic system that helps us to understand that when we bring fish in from the outside, they come in, they go through a period of quarantine where they're cleaned up and they're getting ready to be put on display. I believe right now God is doing that to our ministry. God is doing that to all of us, Christians all over the world. I think God is getting us clean, ready to be put back on display. Maybe we got a little comfortable as Christians. Maybe we got a little common as Christians. Maybe we weren't worshiping or praising as much as we thought we were as Christians. And I thank God. I'm just going to look at the good in it. I'm just going to look at that thing that Satan meant for evil, that God is going to mean it for good. That God is saying, now, I want to spend some time with you. I want to see if you can honor me, love me, be a part of me when no people are around. So that when you get a chance to come back in the church building or go back into public and on your jobs and in your parks and your restaurants and all of that on a full-time basis, you'll be a great display. And somebody's going to ask you, how did y'all make it through this? And how did you make it through that? You've got to tell them it was by the grace of God. And you've got to be able to tell them, if it not had been for the Lord on my side, woo, good Lord, I would not have made it. So you just keep speaking that, and God is going to make sure that he answers his word. Thank you, God, for bringing us through. There was an experiment done between some scientists one day. There were some scientists who a few years ago, they wanted to do an experiment, and they were trying to find out how we react to change. We react to change. I like this example because that's exactly what we're going through right now. How do we react to the change that we're going through? Some of you are getting up every morning, getting dressed to go to work, and walking into an office that's in your own house. You never even knew you had an office. And it can be fun, and it can be cute, and it can be exciting for a minute. But after a while, how does it affect your future? Anyway, they laid four, these scientists laid four tubes side by side on the floor, and they placed a cube of cheese in what was called the second tube. One, two, three, four. They placed a cube of cheese in the second tube, and then they released this mouse. They released this mouse, and the mouse went out, and he went to the first tube, and nothing was in it. And then the mouse went to the second tube, and when he went to the second tube, he found cube of cheese there, and he started to eat that cheese, and that cheese met his need for, key word here, for survival. And so the mouse went back to where they released him. So he got in, went past the first tube, went to the second one, found the cheese, ate it, survived, moved back out. The next day they did the same thing. The mouse again came back, looked at the empty first tube, went to the second tube, and ate the cheese, went back. So that routine kept going for several days. And finally, realizing that he was just wasting time going to that first tube, the mouse went directly from the place that he entered and went to the second tube and started eating. He did that for several times, several days. And so this routine kept going, and the mouse was able to realize, bypass the first tube. Just go to the second tube and start eating. So finally, when the scientists were realizing what they were doing, they started taking the experiment a little further, and so they moved the cheese now from the second tube to the third tube. And so the next day, the mouse came out, and he, of course, bypassed the first one. He went right to the second tube, and the cheese was not there. He was used to his needs being met in that second tube. No cheese, not at all. So how do you think the mouse responded? Did he go back to the first tube? Nope. Did he go back to where he started? No. Did he go to the third tube and start searching for the cheese? Nope. He chose to just stay right at that second tube. He knew that that second tube always worked. He stayed at that second tube where his needs were always met. And he waited and waited and waited for the cheese to come to him. Now, if allowed, because they didn't allow this, if allowed, though, he would have starved to death waiting for that cheese. Instead, he should have just responded to change, because we know from the story that the cheese was in the third cube. I know that may sound a little confusing. And he almost starved to death waiting on that cheese to show up. That sounds a lot like us, doesn't it? We say, well, we'll just wait and see what happens. We've always done it this way. It's worked in the past. That's what got us where we are. So we just keep doing it. But we can learn a lot from this story. Now, to tell the story between a mouse and the cheese is an interesting way to start the sermon. But there's a lot we can learn. First of all, we can learn that if your situation changes, and even though your needs are always have been met there, and you feel a little comfortable with the way that you've always handled things, don't be stuck in the same place blaming others for change. You cannot improve your life without change. He waited there in that second tube, but he realized, I'm just going to stay here and something's going to happen. You can't just blame others for your life when you realize change is inevitable. Technology now, wow, the way we're having to have service and the way we're having to come together now has made us completely aware that change makes us uncomfortable. Boy, just think of all the stuff that's changed around us. And we have become extremely uncomfortable in a lot of areas. But change has also demonstrated that it can eventually lead to improvement. So change has been good. Although change has been uncomfortable, change has been good. Changes in technology have made our lives better in most cases. I don't see anybody walking around now looking for anything in the Yellow Pages or walking around with a book of encyclopedias in your hand. Man, what about roam charges on your cell phone? Remember when you first got a phone, you got all those roaming charges? You could talk like a certain amount of blocks or miles or something, and then you got this phone bill and had all these other roaming charges. Cell phones that made out-only calls or incoming calls only. You know, now we have smartphones, but we had dumb phones for a while. Rabbit ears on televisions. Now, your cable comes underground or through the wall. Remember the home phone cords that just dangled? How about typewriters? All those kind of things that we talked about on last service. Well, those were ways that we got out of things, but we had to enter into other areas because it introduced change. And for those of us that are still alive through several different generations or decades, we have been actually survivors. Now, if you're waiting for things to be like they used to be, you could wind up starving like that mouse, or you might completely feel 100% miserable. See, your past is important. I'm talking to you this morning, IBOC, but don't allow it to eat up your future. It's been good, but if we don't watch it, our past can eat up our future. So go over your past long enough to learn from your mistakes, and then it's time to move forward. The second lesson that we learned from this story, besides just, you know, making sure we understand change, and I'm just introducing this before we get to the message. I know, talking about the mouse still. The second lesson is that your needs, when your needs are met, you got to keep finding other ways to improve. Sometimes when things are good for us and our needs are met, we just kind of sit back and kind of get a little bit, you know, relaxed. And what that mouse didn't realize is that a whole block of cheese could have been waiting in that third or fourth tube, or that fourth tube. But the mouse was comfortable with just that little cube in the second tube. I'm not saying that you have to be greedy, but I want to challenge you to make improvements while things are going well. And then your attitude is better when you make improvements when things are going good. Your stress is less if you make improvements while things are going good. And your thought process is sharper if you make improvements while things are going good. Because if you wait until things start going bad, then your attitude gets off, stress gets a little high, and we're not as sharp as we used to be. So the bottom line before we get into the word today is when things are going well, just keep looking for more cheese. I'm not talking about like ungrateful people. I'm talking about people that can say, God, you've been good, and I want to show you how thankful I am by allowing you to help me bless other people. IBOC is 30 years old now. This month we celebrate cancer survivors. I'm not sure if this ministry or other ministries have ever endured cancerous situations in the church. But as survivors, we have watched people in this ministry survive cancer, diabetes, sickle cell anemia, heart attacks, strokes, losing of a husband, a wife, children, houses burned. We have survived a lot. And the church has been great. It's been a great place. It's been a great place and a great place to be when you go through trials. Because somehow when we go through trials, we go through hard times, we always know that if we have nothing, we always have each other. And because we have each other, we always have something. I'll say it again. We sometimes can feel as if we have nothing, but we always have each other. And if we have nothing and we always have each other, you're going to always have something. So the basic plot of Satan is to make sure that when you go through something that he isolates you. He isolates you totally. Get by yourself. And then your mind will start to tell you that you don't have any friends. You don't have people around. You have no one you can talk to. You have no one that can minister to you. No one to pray with you. And before you know it, you're not surviving. You're just existing. Well, today in the message, I want you to understand that God is calling us survivors. You see, that mouse started eating that cheese because that cheese was his source of survival. And as we go further in ministry, I'm really, really, really starting to understand over and over again that the Word of God is our source of survival. Here we go now. Another round. COVID-19. That's what the government tells us. That's what our health specialist tells us. We're going through another round of COVID-19. We made it through the first round. Yeah, we had some difficult days. We had some tough times. But if we made it one round, I'm thanking God that we'll make it another round. Oh my God, I want to see you in church so bad, so much. I want to see you anywhere so much. I want to see you in stores again. I want to see you basketball games, playing full-time football and all your sports and eating in restaurants and having fun times. But now we're kind of isolated. And now the enemy is telling you that the church is not there for you and you don't need to go to the church because you don't need the God in your life. God's going to show you today the 100% opposite of what the enemy is telling you. So those of you that are listening right now, I want to thank you because if you're tuning into this service right now, you're a member of this church, you've decided, wait a minute. I'm going to stand with God's word. I'm going to stand by our church. I'm going to stand by our men and women of God. I'm going to stand on the promises of God. And I'm going to hear trials and hear tribulations, but I'm going to let the devil hear me praise. And I want to thank you this morning that in spite of everywhere else and everything else you could be doing, today you have decided to stand on God's word and be in service with us. Man, it won't be too long. We'll be back in here on Thanksgiving, or we'll be back in here for Christmas, or we'll be back in here for somebody else's birthday or celebrating something. We'll be back, and you know we'll be back. But how about this? God has allowed us to have the technology to go through change and not be isolated. Can you imagine what the enemy was probably thinking when he kind of conjured up this disease, that if I can get him out of church, I can get him out of God. But God blessed us with technology, and here we are. I want somebody to say, thank you, Lord. Let's look at the scripture this morning and get a lesson, and then I'll let you go on about your day. All right? It says here in Hebrews 10:35. So don't throw it all away now. I'm talking to you, survivors. Don't throw it all away now. You were sure of yourselves then. It's still a sure thing. But you need to stick it out. Staying with God's plan so you'll be there for the promised completion. You have a promised completion. A promised completion. This morning, I want to talk to you, and this is going into our church on a real personal level now. I want to talk to you about survivors. Survivors. People will call you, people can call you, people probably have called you, people might call you anything but a child of God. But I guarantee you, if you've been around this ministry at all, somebody's going to call you a survivor. That's your title. That's how God sees you. More than a conqueror. He sees you as a survivor. When you've struggled in a situation for a while, and it's kind of easy to be a little complacent and bound by yourself. And a lot of people give up and they quit right before the blessings come. Let me tell you something. I want you to keep fighting and struggling and working with this ministry and working around people that are around you, because your courage ultimately is measured by how much it takes to discourage you enough to quit. Who's going to, and what's going to discourage you enough to quit? And I've been there before. I've been there before. I never wanted to quit on God, but sometimes I wanted to even give up on people. God said, no, stand firm. Stand tall. God said, be bold. There's a man in the Bible, in the book of St. John, the 5th chapter. I love the story, because it's just so typical of us. There was a place where people would go before they would go into the temple. They could go into a place called Bethesda's Pool. It's a cool story. Almost all of us know about the story. And Bethesda's Pool was a place like a pool right before you went into the temple. Very spiritual place. And Jesus did two miracles there. One of them, he healed a blind man. So it was called the House of Mercy. So a person being there, hallelujah, needed mercy. Listen to me. And right now, somebody listening to me, you need mercy. You're saying, Lord, I can't handle it by myself. And Lord, it's getting kind of tough. And you ever heard somebody say, Lord, have mercy? Right now, if you're just listening to me, I want you to just say, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And mercy will step in right now. Mercy will solve and soothe you right now. And so this was called the House of Mercy. But in the House of Mercy, right before you went to the House of Mercy, there was this pool there. Bethesda's Pool was the House of Mercy. And there was a pool of people there that were all sick. All of them were sick. And in St. John, the 5th chapter, I'll just walk through it with you. In the 6th verse, we know the story, so I just want to tell you how we're going to use it today. And this man was there. He'd been sick there for 38 years, and a lot of people around him were sick too. And Jesus came to him one day and said, hey, man, do you want to be whole? Because you keep hanging around this church. You keep coming up here, this mercy place. You've been there for 38 years, and chances are, you know, maybe Jesus had seen him several times, because Jesus was always there at the temple. But the man was always there, and the man was always there. And so finally Jesus has this conversation with him. And when he has this conversation with him, what he hears is the man is not saying, I'm grateful to be alive. The man is not saying, I thank God that the people are so nice to me. The man is not saying, the Lord has brought me for 38 years, even though I couldn't walk. Jesus said, do you want to be whole? And the man, instead of saying yes, he said, I don't have nobody. He went into a negative. I have no man. I don't have anybody when the water is troubled to put me in the pool, because at that pool, certain times the water would be, I'm just going to say for the sake of our children, it could be blessed. And when you got into blessed water, it would heal your sicknesses and diseases. So all he had to do was get in the water. And in that time, the water was troubled by the Spirit of God or an angel of God, and he could be healed. But every time he said, I don't have anybody to put me in the water. Jesus didn't ask him about anybody. Jesus didn't ask him about what was going on inside. Jesus didn't ask him about all the other people around. But man, since you're hanging around the church so much, since you got to just show up here, since you got to come to the mercy place, do you want to be whole? Why are you here? And he said, well, I don't have anybody. Jesus didn't say all of that. Jesus just told the man, look, rise up and walk. He cut the man's complaining down because the man had a simple question that he could have answered. The question, the answer, yes, I want to be whole. He never answered the question. I'm talking about survivors. I'm talking about survivors. Are you here this morning listening to this broadcast in the comfort of your own home and you have not answered the question? What if the question is, why are you listening this morning? Why are you listening this morning? I want to hear a word. What are you grateful for today? Surviving. I'm just giving you some pre-question answers. Do you want to be whole? Do you want your finances whole? Do you want your life whole? Do you want anything around you to be healed? The answer is just yes. But this man went on and on and on. How many people do you know can go on and on and on and on? Because when you go on and on and on and on, you get a lot of people listening to you going on and on and on and on. And eventually this man was sitting there and he was lying about every single born again person or person that was a believer of faith or person that was there, because he said, I have no man when the water's troubled. And that included Jesus and his disciples, because Jesus had been there several times. So he puts Jesus in that same category of saying, I don't have nobody to help me. And Jesus is going, now that's a lie, because I've been here. But you are so complaining about what's not right that you are looking your blessing in the face. So don't put these excuses out on the church. Jesus said, don't put these excuses out on the temple. I'm asking you, do you want to be well? And you're going on about who's not helping you. And Jesus just shut him off. Let me show you what I mean. And he just said, get up. And when you get up, don't just get up. Take that, whatever you brought in front of the temple. Take that with you. Don't leave that stuff around. Take the mat and every trace of what you thought you needed. Get that out of here. Rise up and walk. And that's all we hear about this man. And in the midst of that, he was a survivor. But I'm going to tell you what I appreciate. It takes courage for you and that man to stand up today, roll up your mat, and get moving. And blaming other people for your situation, that don't take any courage. That's pretty much a pretty cowardly move. Well, if they hadn't done this and they hadn't done this, then I wouldn't have done this. Would you like to get well? This is my question for you this morning. Do you want to get better? That's a simple question that God is asking us. So I'm saying this morning that we need to stand firm. And either we're going to stand firm or we're going to let go. How long are you going to be a part of the movement of God? How long are you going to be in the church of God? How long are you going to be a Christian? How long are you going to be a believer? When things get tough. And they will get tough. They will get tough. They've been tough. They'll get tough again. A lot of people face decisions every day in their lives, even about their careers. How long am I going to stay on this job? How long am I going to stay with this? Is this a job or am I going to let go of my dream? How long am I going to stay in school? How long am I going to go through these courses? How long am I going to go? How long? How long? How long? We all ask that question. How long? And then we eventually come to this point where you say, I don't think that I have the strength to endure this. So here's my question. How do you know whether to persevere or to let go? How do you know when to let go? How do I know, God, when to stand still? And how do I know when to let go? How do I know when to let go? How do I know when to stand still? Or how do I know when to let go? How do I know when to stand firm? How do I know when to take up my mat and walk? Man, we've learned during this COVID-19, this crisis that we've come through, staying in the thing too long could lead you into some bankruptcy. It could lead to you losing your job, you know, because people stay in a job and get kind of like, man, I don't know what else to do. I don't know what's going to happen. So now Satan is after our very strong finances because he knows we're tithers. He knows we're givers. So he says, what I got to do is separate you from what's making you grow and have seeds with it. I can move your way because I know you work by faith. And I know when you give by faith. And I know that when you give, God starts to bless you. So what I need to do is move you away from that. And so here's the question. When do you persevere? When you say, no, I'm going to give. Or when do you say, I'm going to let it go? Your careers are on the line. Your children's health is on the line. Your mindset is on the line. And in 30 years, guys, we have been able to continue to survive it. You need to answer three questions if you're trying to figure out when to let it go or not. How is God going to direct my life? That's one. How has God directed my life? We made it with this word right here. And Satan is after that. If he can just catch you enough out of that. Because there's so many other ways now. Remember with technology, so many other ways to hear so many other things. But faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That's one. You know, how God directed my life. Am I closer to God now than I've been before or further? Do I pray more than I used to? Do I give more than I used to? Do I love and forgive more than I used to? Used to be so much. So, man, somebody would do something to you. Jump right on it. It's not that way anymore. Sometimes the world and the devil and the enemy and even saints are saying, come on, you need to stand up and fight like a man. God said, you need to stand like a soldier. Having done all to stand, God says, stand. We couldn't do that a few years ago. But if I had just let go, I don't know if I'd be able to stand now. If I had not been able to persevere and he strengthened me like he's strengthening you, I probably would have run right with the enemy. And goodness and mercy would not have followed me if I stepped outside of that and said, God, I'm taking this in my own hands. Somebody stay with me this morning. Somebody stay with me. I'm talking to survivors. A second thing, question that you might want to answer is, are all the signs to keep going coming because of my dream, or is it because of what God wants in my life? You can want to persevere or keep going just because you got personal dreams. Or is all of this adding up to what God wants in my life? Sometimes we have our own personal things we want to do. And sometimes God is like, it might not seem like you want to do your thing right now, but I'm using you and I'm going to bless your thing. If you thank your Holy Spirit for this word. If you seek first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness, then listen, I'm going to make sure all these other things are added to you. But are you going to persevere? Are you going to stand strong enough to seek first the kingdom of God? And now watch all these things start being added to you. Watch them come. 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 You got so many things and so many favors and so much happening that you just got stuff standing around. We're probably the most junky people we've ever been in all our lives, because that's what happens when you get so many blessings. You just start overflowing. You got more blessings than you have a house and cars or storages and places to put them in. Why? Because you're a survivor. Can you handle a little bit more of this word? Can you handle just a little bit more of this word? Sometimes I have to make sure that I'm not just going on, because letting go can be because I'm listening to the wrong advice. I'm persevering because I'm listening to the wrong advice. Or somebody can say, well, if I were you, this is what I would do. Then all of a sudden, you're listening to friends and relatives and maybe people who don't have any direction for where you're going. But sometimes they can kind of offer some suggestions on where they think you might be going. And they're not really skilled with it. They just want to be there in your corner. And there's nothing wrong with people loving you. If you have prayed, and I mean diligently prayed the matter through, if you sought wise counsel and the answer is to stay the course, then just cling to the promise. Just cling to the promise. God, what do I do? What do I do? I'm here. I don't know what. I don't know. I'm getting tried. And so you're getting tried. You've done it. You've done nothing but try to live for Jesus. And people call you, people talk to you, people discourage you. No, you're doing it. Lord, I'm just trying to live for the Lord. Why am I going through all this? God said, now, before you decide to let it go, first of all, I'm talking to you, the survivor. And I thank God for you. But before you decide to let it go, wherever you're going, if you've prayed the matter through, and I mean sought wise counsel through the Holy Spirit and the people of God, and the answer is to stay the course, he's going to say, stay, and I'm going to give you strength while you stay now. Then you just cling to the promise. Bible says in 2 Chronicles 20:17, Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Go out and face them. Go out and face them tomorrow. Go ahead. And the Lord will be with you. He'll never leave you and he'll never forsake you. Now, standing firm is kind of difficult if you know what you ought to do. But sometimes you need other people to stand with you. Standing firm is good. You know, we know right from wrong. We know how to do it. But sometimes you need other people to stay with you. So the rest of the message here, I want to kind of focus on something. And I use the mouse to help us to understand change is important. Change is important. If you missed the message at the beginning of the sermon, I told a story about a mouse who almost starved to death because he didn't know how to change from where he was used to getting his cheese. And now I want to switch this and just kind of talk through an illustration from this message of being able to survive. If you've ever been into a climate that's kind of dry or noticed the climate in a place like Arizona or West Texas, we talk about this part of the world, you've seen what we call tumbleweeds all over the place. And tumbleweeds just blow. They blow here and there in different directions. Tumbleweeds are not stable. Tumbleweed is an above the ground plant. And once that tumbleweed is mature and once it's dry, it disengages. Now, please hear me good. It disengages from the root and it tumbles away with the wind. Now, I'm talking, yes, in a form of Christianity, a form of what we are when we say, God, am I a survivor? Usually after a person gets a little bit more mature and a little stronger. It's not when you're younger, when you're a little stronger and say, oh, I can make it without this. I can make it without that. Jesus talked about it with the prodigal son. And we sometimes say, God, I don't have to go to church every Sunday. I don't have to be in the word. I mean, I don't have to really give like I do. I got other things on my mind. So the tumbleweed kind of disengages and it blows in the wind. And when the wind blows from the east, the tumbleweed will go east. From the west, the tumbleweed will go east. When the wind comes in from the east, the tumbleweed will go west. It does not control where it goes. The wind is in charge of the tumbleweed. I'll say that again. The wind is in charge of the tumbleweed. I'll say that one more time. The wind is in charge of the tumbleweed. In your life right now, if you're not rooted in God, the wind is being in charge of your next move. So whatever comes across the airwaves next, whatever comes across next, whatever comes across this next, if you're not stable, if you don't understand your survival is in God's word, the winds are going to come. That's why there keeps being strong winds blowing. And it tosses us to and fro, up and down. We're happy, we're sad, we're in, we're out, we're up, we're down. We're together, we're apart. Just like the tumbleweed. But I don't want to talk about the tumbleweed because that's just not a very good description of what we are here at IBOC. I don't believe that. That's not, and I know there are other people listening that are not from IBOC, but this being our church anniversary month, I need you to understand how we were able to survive. So the tumbleweed is not really, once it gets grown, it kind of disengages. And let me say this, it's people will disengage from church now, a church building, because your careers change, your marital status change. I mean, your lives change, you move. But that's not what I'm talking about. With change, God has been able to tell us that even if you move like Sister Simone to Germany, you can still stay rooted and connected to that same word of God that got you here. But I want to talk about something else this morning, not just the tumbleweed. I want to talk about something called a redwood tree. A redwood tree. Now, we don't know a whole lot about redwood trees, but I'm going to try to paint a picture so clear to you in these next few minutes that you will understand a redwood tree. And if we're standing here this morning as an inspiring body of Christ Church, I want you to know that we are here because we resemble redwood trees. Now, if you've never seen a redwood tree, it's an amazing, magnificent tree. Yeah, that's what it is. It's an amazing, magnificent tree. It's huge. A redwood tree is about 300 feet tall. 300 feet tall. You know how tall 300 feet is? 300 feet is the size of a football field. So a redwood tree could lie from one side of the AT&T Stadium to the other side. That's how tall a redwood tree is. I thought we were talking about the church. Yes, I am. I'm talking about the survivors and inspired by the Christ church, like redwood trees. And when you're redwood trees, you kind of tower and you try not to be visible. My God, we've tried not to be seen. We've tried not to be. We've just tried to go about doing God's work and trying to help the community, help neighbors, and trying to help people and just bless, 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 bless. But at some point, you can't hide your blessing. Your blessings will outgrow you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You can't hide the fact that God is nurturing you. You can't hide the fact that God is encouraging you. You can't hide the fact that you have joy. So that redwood tree is 300 feet tall. That's the size of a football field. And it towers over other trees. And one of the things you learn about the redwood tree is that redwood trees have scars that reflect tough times. They've been through a lot. You can't be, whoo, hallelujah. You can't be 300 feet without being attacked at 50 feet and then 75 feet. And then maybe 100 feet, and then 150 feet. So every time you look around, looks like you're getting attacked. And when the enemy expects you to fall down, God keeps giving you the strength to climb up. I'm talking to some redwood trees this morning. But these trees have scars on them that reflect their tough times. Some even have huge caverns carved through the trunks that fires have called. You'll see pictures kind of float up now as I talk about these redwood trees. I kind of want you to kind of look at them as I talk about them. But the one thing about the redwood trees, even though they've been scarred, here's what most people can't understand. Even though you've been scarred and you may have been in this ministry for a long time, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, I don't know how long you've been here. But one thing about the redwood trees is even though they've been scarred, here's what the devil hates. They still grow. That's what makes you a survivor. I've watched people come through chemo. I've watched people go through radiation. I've watched people who couldn't, were still nauseated, they couldn't hold anything on their stomach. I've watched them become so frail, so thin, and then all of a sudden somebody says a thing is in remission or whatever it is that the enemy tries to call it. God calls it healed, and that's why I believe by his stripes we are, and I've seen them gain their strength back. And the amazing thing that has a Satan scratching his head about the church is of all the things he's tried to use to kill the body of Christ over the years and all the scars and all the strife, we still grow. Why? Why? One word. We're what? Survivors. We're survivors. It's difficult to kill a redwood tree. And the secret to the redwood tree, I'm talking about the tree now. Yeah, I was talking about the mouse earlier. I'm talking about the tree now. I'm not talking about tumbleweeds. I'm talking about those of you that are listening to me right now. I'm talking to you, redwood tree. Amazing thing about a redwood tree is that the survival of the tree is not just in the tree itself. It grows in clusters. They grow in clusters. You don't just see a redwood tree sticking up there by itself. They grow in clusters. See, you might see a church on a block. You might see a church over in a field. You may see a church up on a hill. But the body of Christ, the church, we grow in clusters. Oh no, we give the devil a fit. The redwood tree grows in clusters. And the strength of the redwood tree is in the root system. It's in the root system. Now pay attention to this because we're going to go pretty quick from this point on. It's in the root system. Now, the redwood tree doesn't have a typical root system. Most roots, when they grow, they grow down. They grow down. Now, remember what I said. The redwood tree is about 300 feet tall. So you would think that the roots grow at least, you know, straight down because If you look at a redwood tree, their roots only grow about 12 feet in the ground. That's about as deep as they get. What? A 300-foot tall tree only has 12 feet in the ground? That means anything could knock it over. Stay with me, survivors. You better stay with me, survivors. Come on, IBOC. This is your word today. You would think that if a tree is 300 foot tall, that it would at least need to go down 900 feet in order to keep it from blowing over when the wind hit. You're exactly right. Except It doesn't grow 900 feet down. The roots go 900 feet wide. I need somebody to say, Lord, I'm grateful that I'm connected. See, sometimes you can be so deep. You can focus on being so deep. You can focus on saying, I'm so good. I'm so right. I have the right to this. But the question is ultimately going to be, what are you connected to? Jesus asked this man, do you want to be well? In other words, I know you've been here a long time, but have you affected anything by being here? Are you bringing positives or bringing negatives by being here? The redwood tree can withstand a lot of stuff. Fires can come and burn it. Why? Because it's connected to other redwoods in the grove. I'm going to call it the grove. The grove is here. It's connected in the grove. Those of us that are Christians right now, we're connected in the grove. Our senior citizens, our young people, our teenagers, our youth, our deacons, our ushers, our choirs, our technical people, right? Our ministries, our musicians, all of it. The ushers, the hospitality teams, all the churches, I don't care what you call your church. If you're a born again Christian, see, we're connected in the grove, and the enemy's still trying to figure out, if I can just take out one of them, I can affect all of them. And according to the Lord, and we're connected in the grove, he said, you can't take out any of us. The gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. The roots in the redwood tree, they're intertwined so tightly that it's impossible to tell which one is which or which belongs to which tree. Because we're all so close together. There may be people that say, yeah, I've been to church and I was in the church and I've done this in the church. The question is not how long were you in the church, but did you reach anybody? Did you reach anybody while you were there? I mean, did you reach anybody? Did you rescue anybody? Did you help heal anybody? Did you have an impact on someone's life in a positive way? Yeah, you were there every service. Mm-hmm. Did you change anybody, though? Did you encourage somebody? And when you moved on with your life, as you got older, did you bring someone with you or did you take someone away? Did you persevere or did you let it go? Each tree, each one of the redwood trees, you got to understand, is independent. They're by themselves, but they all connect through the roots. And they all have the same common goal. Survival. This tree depends on this tree. It doesn't look like it, but underneath all of these twines, they're connected by what? One word, survival. And everybody listening to me this morning, I need you to understand that that's how God has connected us, because we are survivors. Your faith walk is similar. If you stand alone, if you stand alone, not connected with each other Christians, your faith walk is going to look like a tumbleweed. If you stand alone and you're not connected with other Christians, you're going to look like a tumbleweed. You're going to just be tossed to and fro. And that's why somebody can say, well, I went to church. I really don't go that much. And just watch. Satan can use you to say things, to add things, to do things, because now you're just drifting. You put your trust in humans, you put your trust in people, then people are going to do what they do. They're going to hurt you. They're going to let you down. But you put your trust in God. God says, what I'm going to do is build your faith. Now, let me tell you, we're moving this message now, that it takes courage to stand firm. And it takes courage to look beyond whatever the situation is in your life and to hope and to trust that God is going to provide for us. That takes a lot of courage, because it looks bad sometimes. It looks gloomy sometimes. When we first entered into this COVID-19, it looked bad. It looked horrible. And as we've gone further and further, the outcast doesn't look any brighter. The forecast looks even darker. But it's amazing how God has continued to give us hope, how God has continued to give us strength, how we have said, Lord, what are we going to do now? We were planning this and we were planning that. God told me the other day, just keep planning, son. Just keep planning. Keep planning. I got plans for you, and my plans are for a future and a hope. I want you to keep planning. Somebody with me right now listening, I need need you to say, keep planning. Just keep planning. Keep planning. And as you plan, you plant. As you plan, you plant. I'm not talking about just offering. We got to plan, and we got to plant because we expect something to grow. I'm talking about plant your prayers. I'm talking about plant your faith. I'm talking about plant your anointing. I'm talking about plant a word of God. You got to keep planning and keep planting. And I guarantee you, the enemy gets amazed when he knows that you are supposed to be completely wiped out, but somehow you are still planning. How can you plan for a future when the devil says, I'm taking you out this season? And you say, in the name of Jesus, not now, not like this, and not this season, because God has a plan for my life. And wherever you are right now, you ought to give him glory for that. You give him glory for that. You give him glory for that. It takes courage to stand firm. I'm not saying you're not going to get hit. Good God Almighty. You redwood tree, I'm talking to you. You've been burned. You look a mess. You look frail. You look like it's working. You look like you're not going to make it. But the enemy is surprised because you're still standing. Your outside is beat up, but you're connected to so many. 30 years of preaching, 30 years of teaching, 30 years of anointing, 30 years of helping, 30 years of leaning and depending on Jesus, 30 years of speaking in tongues, and 30 years of being laughed at, and 30 years of being mistreated, and 30 years of being filled with the Holy Spirit. You think God's going to let us go now? Absolutely not. And if God's not going to let us go, he's expecting you to not let him go. Why? Because I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. I got bruises. I got scars. But I got joy. So when we look at this, I got two words for you as a survivor. It's time for you to hope again. I say it's time for you to hope again. He's the one that says that he gave us future and the hope. And hope is wonderful. It's a beautiful gift from God. Hope is a source of strength, and hope is a source of courage when you're going through your hardest trials. Sometimes when you're hoping and you're believing God, you just need one thing to just increase your hope. Just, Lord, just give me one sign, one sign. Just give me one thing. Somebody right now, just Lord, just give me one sign. Just one today that you got it. Just give me one sign. Let somebody say something nice, God. Let something good happen so that I can know, God, that you got it. Cancel some assignments so that I'll know that you got it. God, just give me a sign of hope. God's gift of hope, it kind of looks like this. When you're trapped in a tunnel and you're just miserable, hope points to the light at the end. See, that's what hope will do for you. It looks like this. When you're overwhelmed and when you're exhausted, hope gives you fresh energy. That's what hope looks like. It kind of looks like this. When you feel discouraged, hope lifts your spirits. That's why the devil doesn't want you to have any hope. It looks like this. When you feel tempted to quit, hope tells you to keep going. I know I'm talking to a survivor this morning now. This is what hope looks like. When we lose our way and we're confused and we look, that the way looks kind of blurry and the destination looks like I just can't even see it anymore. Hope dulls the edges when you get panicked, and hope says it's going to be all right. This is what hope looks like. When you struggle with a crippling disease or a sickness or lingering illness, hope helps us to persevere beyond the pain. This is what hope looks like. This is what hope looks like. I'm talking to you, Mr. and Miss Survivor. When you feel the worst, hope reminds us that God is still in control. This is what hope looks like. I'm telling you to hope again, hope again, hope again. When we have to endure the consequences of bad decisions, hope fuels our recovery. I don't think I can make it, God. Hope says, oh, yes, you will. This is what hope looks like. I'm talking to you, Mr. Redwood Tree. You, Miss Survivor. You, Mr. Survivor. When we're forced to sit back and just wait, and you want to do something, hope gives you the patience to just trust. That's what hope looks like. When you feel rejected and you feel abandoned, hope reminds us that we're not alone. Hope tells you you're going to make it. When you feel that you've had to say your final farewell to someone you love, someone you hope. Hope in the life beyond this one carries us through grief, knowing that we're still going to be all right. The Bible says, they that wait on the Lord, oh, that hope in the Lord, waiting on him, hope in the Lord, shall renew their strength. They're going to soar on wings like eagles. They will run. Maybe you've run for a lot of years and your run is slowed down a little bit. God said, no, there's still some will there. You will run and not grow weary. You will walk and not faint. Trust God. He's given you the gift of hope. You're a survivor. You're a survivor. So what did he start with us today? What did God just tell us a few minutes ago? So, you survivor. You're still here. You're wondering, am I supposed to stick with my church? What am I supposed to do? God said, don't throw it all away now. You assure yourselves then, and you weren't even as strong as you are now. It's a sure thing, but you need to stick it out. Stand with God's plan. That's what you need to do. So you'll be there for the guaranteed, promised completion. It takes courage to stand firm and trust Jesus when you're afraid, when you're unsure, when you lack confidence in yourself. We've been there. We've done that. And sometimes God says, I'm going to build you up so that you can come through something that no one else can comprehend. Somebody listen to me right now. You may be having a Job experience. Seems like the devil has attacked every area of your life. The best God has for us is sometimes not far from what we fear the most. It's right there. God says, if you wake up tomorrow and just claim to be a survivor, you'll survive this. I want to thank everybody that's listening this morning. You had a choice. You had a choice today. You did. You had a choice to just sit here for just a minute and say, God, talk to me. And I thank God that you chose to listen. I want you to say, Lord, thank you. Just say it. Say, Lord, thank you. I'm a survivor. I want you to lift your thank you, Lord, hand and say, thank you, Lord. I've survived. And then lift your other thank you, Lord, hand and say, thank you, Lord. I survived. Now you're praising. And as long as God can see your hands up, he'll continue to send that rope. And that's something to hold on to. Now, maybe you're listening today and you say, well, Pastor Rush, I had a difficult time. I don't know what to do. I want to be in church and I'm just so busy. And maybe you say, I was a member, but you left. That's okay. Okay. It happens. It happens. Maybe some things have happened and made you change your whole prayer and say, wait a minute. Where was I when the church needed me? When I needed the church was there. I didn't understand it then. I didn't understand it. I didn't know what God was doing. I didn't know God was strengthening me. I didn't know God was giving me courage. I didn't know God was teaching me how to be a professional. I thought I was in a bunch of room with people and they only liked certain people and they liked these people and they had their favorites and he liked them and she liked them. I had no idea God was building character in me. But now that I'm over something and now that I'm leading other things, I realized he was keeping me. God was really keeping me. He was raising me up. And now I got to go back. And I want to be there. I don't know if you'll make another 30 years with the church, but you can make another 30 minutes. Then go for 30 days. 30 months. But just give him 30 for 30. The church was there before you came. And it'll be here after we're gone because we're Redwoods. You're a survivor. And if you're one of those people that say, okay, I want to be a member of IBOC. I want to be able to be at the celebration, the victory party. When Corona passes, when trouble passes, I want to be able to say, God, I had on my whole armor, and I withstood the fight, and I fought the strong fight of faith. That's you? Just do me a favor right now. You can just go to Join IBOC. Okay? Join IBOC. You'll see it. Join IBOC 31996. Join IBOC. Join, I've already been a member. Yeah, but you know, you can walk away. It's okay to come back. We used to call it just rededicating. I just want to rededicate my life. I want to come back, God. I want to rededicate my life. I let a lot of things get between me and you, God. I let a lot of things get between me and the church. I did. But God, I want to come back. It's okay to do that. Right now, all you have to say is just repeat after me. Say, Lord, you never left me. And like the prodigal son, maybe I drifted. Lord, I'm still saved. And I still love you. But I want to come back today and be a part of the prayers of the righteous and be a part of this redwood tree family. I want to be a testimony and tell my story of survival.
Thank you, Father.
Watching and for being bold and unashamed. Looking for even more content from IBOC and Pastor Ricky G. Rush? Make sure you're following IBOC and Pastor Rush on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. For even more info right at your fingertips, the new mobile app is available for iOS and Android in the iTunes and Google Play stores. And don't forget that an important part of accomplishing God's mission are the tithes and offerings we receive from faithful viewers just like you. Won't you make a difference and become a fisher of men, supporting the ministry work of IBOC and helping us change thousands of lives all over the world? Visit us online at ibocchurch.org or on our mobile app to make your donation. You can also give through Givelify in just a few short steps. Thanks for your support. That's it for now, but be sure to tune in next week for another powerful message from the Master Illustrator, Pastor Ricky G. Rush.